Okay, hi everyone. So today we are going to discuss about hepatitis B management in adults. So myself, Dr. Lavkesh Anand, I'm a consultant gastroenterology and hepatobiliary sciences at Manipal Hospital, Dwarka. And with me is Dr. Shukla, who will be discussing about neonatal hepatitis subsequently. So to begin with, so my talk will cover the following topics. First is the natural history, epidemiology, goals and indication of therapy. How are we currently managing hepatitis B? How do we monitor the therapy? What are the stopping rules? And how do we do the surveillance for liver cancer? What are the various treatment guidelines and certain clinical case vigilance? So globally, this chronic hepatitis is a health problem. It is the most common chronic viral infection in the world. And there are certain, according to the prevalence, various places are divided. And our country is somewhere in the intermediate group. And China comes in the high group. Overall in the Asia, it is very high prevalence group. An estimated around 240 million people worldwide are living with chronic hepatitis B. As regards India, chronic hepatitis B again is a public health problem, and around 40 million HBV carriers are there. 10 to 15% of all the pool in the world is in India, and there are 43 to 45 million new cases per year. 1 lakh deaths annually are attributable to hepatitis B, and of the 25 million newborns annually, 1 million run lifetime risk for hepatitis B. So let's discuss briefly about the routes of transmission. So there are broadly two routes of transmission. One is the horizontal transmission, another is a vertical transmission. Horizontal transmission, it is by the sexual contact, exposure to blood or body fluids, hemodialysis, organ, blood and semen donors, IV drug use and prolonged close contact. Whereas the vertical transmission is from the infected mother to the child. Approximately 25 to 50% of acute infection in the children aged 1 to 5 years and less than 5% in older children and adults progress to chronic hepatitis B, and 90% of the infants born to E positive mothers develop chronic hepatitis B. So if we discuss only in India, then the mother baby transmission is the commonest, and there are various studies which have shown around 80 to 90% rate of transmission. This was one study way back in 1987, another study in 2011, which have shown that patients who have high DNA, they have 100% risk of transmission. 3/4 of the hepatitis B in India is through the mother-baby transmission, and thus the role of pediatrician is paramount. So this another study in 2006 in which 116 hepatitis B positive children were studied, and it was seen that 74% mother had evidence of hepatitis B viral infection. And thus they postulated that any adult who come to us with hepatitis B, their mother and their siblings should be checked for anti-hepatitis B E titer, anti-HB code total and anti-HBS. And if we do this screening, it is found that 18% family members are found to be hepatitis B positive. Therefore, the message is that we should screen all patients, and the screening should mean not only HBS AG, it should mean these four tests before vaccinating anyone. And if any patient comes to you with hepatitis B positive, HBS AG positive, to all the family members, these four tests should be advised by you. Now, when does HBV transmission occur during pregnancy? So one is during gestation. So now the studies, initially it was thought that it is the delivery when the transmission is there during delivery, which is called the perinatal transmission. But now it is seen that transmission occurs throughout the gestation, that is intrauterine transmission. And it is now considered more important route of transmission than only the delivery. And even in the postnatal period, the transmission can occur, which is considered important. And this transmission is prevented by immunoprophylaxis. We give hepatitis B vaccination to the newborn and also HBIC, that is hepatitis B immunoglobulin, at the time of birth. But what happens during transmission during gestation? To prevent that, we need to give antivirals to the pregnant female during delivery, during pregnancy itself. Now we come to the natural history of hepatitis B. Now, natural history very much depends on the host immune response. So if we see that if the patient has a very good immune response, vigorous immune response, it leads to acute hepatitis. In acute hepatitis, there will be high transaminitis, that is ALT will be more than 400. And in most of these cases, around 95% of the cases, they will be full recovery. And few of these patients, they can also present to us with fulminant hepatitis or acute liver failure, which can lead to death or it can also recovery. But the rule is that if the patient has a good immune response, it will lead to either full recovery or in few cases death. But if there is a weak immune response, then it leads to persistent infection. Patient can come to us either in the carrier stage, chronic hepatitis, cirrhosis or liver cancer. There are two different stages in that. One is the immune tolerant stage in which the ALT is normal, and one is the immune active stage in which the ALT will be high. And there is there is rotation between this ALT immune tolerant phase and immune active phase, which happens every 4.3 months. And the best example of this weak immune response is the infants, in which there is no, the immunity is not well developed. Therefore, they do not have immunity against this infection, which is transmitted to them from the mother, and thus they have chronic infections which persist throughout life in them and come to us many times incidentally. So this is termed as IDAHS, which is called incidentally detected asymptomatic HBsAg positive subjects. Many a times you must have encountered that a patient says that he went for blood transfusion, blood donation, and on screening he was found to be HBsAg positive, but he's asymptomatic. So such patients, these instead of saying have HBsAg carriers or chronic hepatitis B, the term now is IDHS. This was one study in 2008 in which it was seen that HBV DNA in such patients of normal ALT can be very high in 60%. And in patients who had intermittently normal ALT, it was 72% had a high HBV DNA. And even in these, 40% of these IDHS patients had, with normal ALT, had a hepatic fibrosis ranging from F2 to F4. Even 3.7% had F4 fibrosis, which means that they are either pre-cirrhotic or cirrhotic. So it is important to detect these patients, to evaluate these patients, because these patients may turn up directly into cirrhosis or liver cancer to you someday. Now, chronic HBV carrier is a misleading term. It is now replaced by chronic hepatitis B virus infection. So what happens in this chronic hepatitis B? Around 8 to 40% of the patients, they go to cirrhotic stage. Cirrhosis means there's an irreversible damage. How do we define chronic infection? It is defined as the persistence of positive test result for HBsAg or HBV DNA for at least 6 months. Of these, cirrhotic patients, 10 to 17% can cause hepatic cancer. 15% can go to decompensated liver disease or liver failure, and both of these ultimately require liver transplantation. Otherwise, there is 70 to 80% chances of death. Now, what are the various factors that lead to this hepatitis B progression? There are certain host factors, viral or disease factors, and environmental factors. Host factors important is more than 40 years of age, male gender, family history of hepatocellular cancer, and African or Asian race. Thus, we are at a higher risk of this progression. Viral factors are the high DNA level, high HBsAg quantitative level, prolonged time to HBe antigen seroconversion. Seroconversion means conversion of HBe antigen to anti-HBe. Development of E-negative chronic hepatitis B, genotype C or D. There are various genotypes for hepatitis B. So just genotype C or D has a higher risk of progression, and Indians have more of genotype D. Then basal core promoter mutations, elevated ALT levels, and presence of fibrosis or cirrhosis. There are certain environmental factors like co-infection with hepatitis C, hepatitis D, or HIV. Concomitant alcohol consumption, cigarette smoking, aflatoxins, obesity, and or diabetes. So in these risk factors, there are certain causes of HCC development also. And these include the high level of HBsAg, again genotype COD, precore or basal core promoter mutations, increased alpha fetoprotein, decreased baseline ALT and family history of HCC or alcohol consumption. Apart from that, there are certain non-HCC liver deaths, and the cause for that are increased ALT and reduced albumin platelet count, which indicates CLD, ascites, and encephalopathy. And for both of these, there are certain common things like older age, as we have seen more than 40, male sex, cirrhosis, increased DNA load, and HBE antigen status. Now we come to the course of HBV infection. Many of them us are aware of this thing, that there are various stages. Chronic hepatitis B, this follow a variable clinical course, but it is not necessary that all patients will go through each phase. So we have immune tolerant phase. In this immune tolerant phase, there will be a high DNA level and low ALT level. This is often seen in perinatally infected children, and it may last for several decades. And in infection acquired during adulthood or in late childhood, this phase is short or absent. And as there is a high DNA, HBE antigen is positive in these cases, and there is very low rate of HBE antigen seroclearance. ALT will be normal. So when the patient will get this LFT done, it is normal, but it doesn't mean that the patient is normal, but because the DNA level is very high in these patients. And as older age will predict adverse outcomes, it is important to monitor older immune tolerant patients who may show minimally or intermittently elevated ALT. Now the next phase is immune clearance phase. Immune clearance phase, this occurs when there is a ALT starts increasing and the DNA starts decreasing. The patient again maybe will have HBsAg positive, and HBe antigen may start showing some seroconversion. And when there is a HBe antigen seroconversion, it's a serological marker of the end of the immune clearance phase. 10 to 20% will have annual spontaneous HBe antigen seroconversion. This typically occurs during the second or third decade of life and may last for years, leading to progressive liver damage. When we do a liver biopsy, it will show necroinflammation and varying degree of fibrosis as a result of immune-mediated liver damage. And the patients with active liver disease in the immune clearance phase are potential candidates for treatment. Now, the next stage is inactive carrier. In the inactive carrier, there will be E antigen seroconversion, that means E negative and anti-E positive. The HBV DNA will be suppressed to very low or undetectable level, and ALT will also get normalized. On biopsy, there will be mild hepatitis or minimal fibrosis, but it may have severe liver damage also, including cirrhosis. And the term healthy carrier is an erroneous term, because a significant proportion of patients may have high viral load, hepatic fibrosis, and other liver-related complications such as liver cancer. And around 20 to 30% of these patients may experience reactivation after E seroconversion. The next stage is reactivation and resolution. Reactivation may occur spontaneously or due to immunosuppression. The reactivation, what happens? Again, there will be high ALT, there will be DNA will increase. And these patients with reactivation are usually older with more advanced liver disease. And these patients may have increased risk of liver cirrhosis or HCC. Treatment is recommended for E negative chronic hepatitis B who experience reactivation. HBsAg loss, which is called resolution, this occurs in just 0.5 to 2% of Western patients and 0.1 to 0.8% of Asian patients. Some patients may still have detected HBV DNA in serum and are vulnerable to reactivation even in the resolution stage. So this is the natural history of hepatitis B. There is a change in the nomenclature. The old terminology of immune tolerant hepatitis B, in which there is a high DNA, normal ALT, normal liver disease, and E positive, they is now called E positive chronic infection. The previously termed immune reactive E positive patients, they have DNA ranging from 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 7. There is an elevated ALT level, liver disease will be moderate to severe, E positive and HBsAg high. These patients are now called HBe antigen positive chronic hepatitis. The inactive carrier term, which very was used earlier in it, there was a low DNA level, ALT normal, no liver disease, E negative, and HBsAg was also low, is now called HBe antigen chronic infection. And there is the previously used HBe antigen negative chronic hepatitis, in which E was negative but DNA was high, ALT was elevated, and there was moderate to severe liver disease. They are now called HBe antigen negative chronic hepatitis. now how do we evaluate this treatment for medical management? So the patient needs to have a thorough history and physical examination, like the risk factors for hepatitis, risk factor for HIV co-infection, duration of infection, route of transmission, history of alcohol use, comorbid disease, family history of liver cancer. And on evaluation, apart from LFT, we need to have tests for antibodies for HIV, HCV, HIV, HBE antigen and anti-HBE status, and the HBV DNA level that has to be done at 6 month period. Patient should also be screened for HCC in high risk patients. He may or may not require liver biopsy. And if liver biopsy, there are certain non-invasive markers also for liver fibrosis like FibroScan and urine analysis. And patient should be counseled on risk of transmission, screening of the family members, vaccination of at-risk household and sexual contact, and the family planning. So we come to the treatment. Since 1990, when the interferon was first used for hepatitis B, there is a remarkable change in the treatment. And there is now new era of oral therapy in which interferons are not used. The landmark change came from the discovery of entecavir and tenofovir, and now the latest in the basket is tenofovir elafenamide, which is more nephrosafe than the earlier tenofovir diazoxide fumarate. There is also improvement in the efficacy of the seroconversion with these newer anti-nucleoside analogs and nucleotide analogs. Now, which nucleotide to be used? It depends on the safety, the barrier to resistance, because the earlier nucleosides like the lamivudine, adifovir, they are high antiviral potency, but they also had increased chances of resistance. Also the efficacy. So among them, the best are the tenofovir and entecavir, because they have a good antiviral potency, their pharmacological barrier is very high, and genetic barrier for resistance is also high. Only the tenofovir, the earlier one, had nephrotoxicity, which the new TAF had very less incidence. So these are the preferred nucleoside analogs and should be used as a first line therapy. So the 2018, the American guidelines, they say there is not much difference in which to use, but like in pregnancy, this tenofovir is a category B. It is more commonly used than entecavir. There is no human data for TAF now. Renal disease, of course, entecavir is better and TAF can be used. But for the bony diseases, all are good. And if there is a HIV co-infection, the TDF was in the co-formulated in the retroviral regime. TAF is also in the co-formulated in the retroviral regime. But if we use entecavir, it is in addition to the complete ART regimen. The dose that is commonly used is 0.5 milligram for entecavir, TAF 25 milligram per day, and TDF 300 milligram per day. So is there any role of interferon nowadays? So there are certain roles. What are the favorable predictors of response? If the DNA is low, there is high ALT, and the genotype is A or B. But there are certain patient demographics also, like in young people, in young women who want the pregnancy, and there is absence of comorbidities, patient preference, and concomitant Delta infection or HCV. So in these, a course of peg interferon may be the most appropriate first line treatment strategy, and because it has a finite treatment, it is for 1 year of course, and there is a sustained response, and this patients who have a high ALT and low DNA, there is a chances of seroconversion are higher than the nucleoside analogs. But again, there should be a careful patient selection. We cannot use this in patients who have a very high transaminitis and patients who have cirrhosis, be it compensated or decompensated cirrhosis. So only in patients who have chronic hepatitis B, with these parameters, it can be used. There is another way in which this interferon is used, which is called a sequential regime. And in the sequential regime, the patient is first given tenofovir or any other nucleotide analog for 12 weeks, then combined tenofovir and interferon is used for 24 weeks, and then again alone tenofovir is used till the end of 1 year. And it has found in various studies that there is a very good response in such patients. Even the patient can have HBsAg conversion also. Now the next is, who should be treated? Now this is a very confusing and topic, because there are various guidelines from American Association, from the European Association, and the Asia Pacific Association. All these three agree on this, that a patient have a very high DNA level and a high ALT level in E positive patients should be treated, and in E negative patient who have more than 10 to the power 4 log DNA and high ALT should be treated. But in practical this scenario, majority of the patients do not fall in this category. So again, how to monitor this patients on treatment for hepatitis B DNA? So HBV DNA should be detected every 3 months until it is undetectable, and every 3 to 6 months thereafter. ALT similarly should be monitored every 3 monthly until normalization, and every 3 to 6 months thereafter. For E positive patients, HBe antigen should be monitored every 6 monthly until it is negative, and anti-HBe is achieved. And in E negative patients, once sustained suppression of HBV DNA is achieved, HBsAg is monitored every 12 monthly. We call the treatment response by virological response. If there is a definition of non-response, is primary non-response when there is a less than 1 log reduction of DNA at 12 weeks. Partial virological response when there is more than 1 log reduction but still it is detectable. And virological breakthrough when there is a confirmed increase of 1 log DNA from the nadir on treatment. And similarly for the PEG interferon, virological response is when the DNA level is less than 2000 and evaluated at 6 months and at the end of therapy. And sustained off therapy virological response is when the DNA level is less than 2000 for at least 12 months after the end of therapy. The response again are divided into biochemical, histological and serological. Biochemical response is the minimal follow-up of at least 1 year post-treatment with ALT determined every 3 months to confirm sustained off-treatment biochemical response. Histological response is decrease in the necroinflammatory activity by more than 2 points without worsening in fibrosis. And serological response is E antigen loss and seroconversion and HBsAg loss and seroconversion. Usually HBsAg loss is our the goal, the end point which we seek, but there are very less chances of HBsAg loss. So what is the significance of the estimation of this quantitative HBsAg? We all know this HBV DNA is a marker of HBV replication. But what does HBsAg detect? So they are various viral particles which indicates HBV replication. So this HBsAg is a marker of transcriptionally active triple C DNA, which is the core of this HBsAg. So it may be that the DNA is negative, but this virus still remains inside the DNA in the form of active cccDNA. And it's very difficult to detect this cccDNA, so we detect this quantitative HBsAg for this. So another significance is that this HBsAg level provides the complementary information of triple cDNA. The true inactive carriers are those who have HBsAg are less than 1000, HBV DNA less than 2000, and normal serum ALT. In the immune tolerance phase, HBsAg can be more than 1 lakh. An annual rate of HBsAg loss is approximately 0.4 to 2.3%. And HBsAg loss rate is lowest in E positive patients followed by E negative, with the loss rate being highest in inactive carriers. So baseline HBsAg is usually a predictor of HBsAg loss. Both DNA and HBsAg levels positively correlate with HCC development. But in E negative patients, HBsAg level more than 1000 is an independent predictor for HCC development. Thus, it is very important to measure this. And HBsAg level of more than 1000 was noted to be consistently associated with a higher risk of E negative hepatitis and cirrhosis. And thus, combining both DNA and HBsAg level could be used to define minimal risk hepatitis with chronic HBV infection. So what are the rules for stopping this nucleotide analogs? After confirmed HBsAg loss with or without anti-HBs seroconversion, this is the desired endpoint. But in non-cirrhotic E-positive chronic hepatitis B patients, even those who achieve E seroconversion, that means conversion of HBe antigen into anti-HBe and undetectable DNA, and who complete at least 12 months of consolidation therapy. this consolidation therapy means follow up after HPV DNA negative. That there also we can think of stopping, but again there is a chance of recurrence in these patients. In HBe antigen negative patients, in selected non-cirrhotic E negative who have achieved long-term virological at least 3 years of HBV DNA negative under an nucleotide analog, we may consider of stopping it. But still, we perhaps it is indefinite therapy that is usually given in E negative chronic hepatitis B patients because it is considered unsafe to stop nucleotide analogs until we achieve HBsAg negativity. And recent evidence have shown, especially from Asian countries, that nucleotide analog can be discontinued in E negative chronic hepatitis B patients who achieve DNA undetectability on 3 separate occasions, 6 months apart. So either of the 3 we think, but the best of course is when the HBsAg is negative and anti-HBs is present, but it's very less chances of these. So this we have discussed that in E positive and negative. Another thing to remember, in cirrhotic patients, we usually continue the antiviral treatment for life. So a word about HCC surveillance. The surveillance is done by AFP and by abdominal ultrasound. So it should be done every 6 monthly. There are certain high risk patients like those who are cirrhotic and there's a family history of HCC, and low to moderate risk like in inactive carriers, immune tolerant patients, HBsAg positive males less than 40 and female less than 50, and patients with HBsAg loss. These are low risk. So let's see first quickly the guideline. There are various guidelines, but what we follow usually is the Asian Pacific guidelines. There one another NICE guidelines. In the NICE guideline, they have divided according to the FibroScan, which we commonly use. The FibroScan, there is a LSM value. If the LSM value is less than 11, that means it is either F1, F2 or F3 fibrosis. If the patient has a low DNA, we monitor and measure the ALT and DNA level every 24 to 48 weeks. If the DNA is very high, that is more than 10 to the power 5 log, we usually treat. And if the DNA is between 2000 to 20,000, then if the ALT is normal, we can monitor. If the ALT is abnormal and the patient's age is more than 30, we treat. If the patient's age is less than 30, we go for biopsy. The biopsy is normal, again we monitor. But in the biopsy, if it shows F2, F3 fibrosis or evidence of necroinflammation, we have to treat. If the fibrosis is more than 11, which is usually indicative of cirrhosis, and the DNA is detected, we have to treat. This is the NICE guideline. The other APASL guidelines is for E positive and E negative. E positive patients, if the DNA is less than 2000, and ALT is less than upper limit of normal, we monitor the patient. If the patient has a 2000 to 20,000 DNA level in E positive, ALT is more than upper limit of normal, we monitor 3 to 6 months, assess fibrosis. If there is F2, F3 fibrosis or moderate to severe inflammation biopsy, we have to treat. And if the DNA is more than 20,000, and ALT is 1 to 2 times upper limit of normal, again we monitor for 3 to 6 months by means of either FibroScan or EPRI. We assess the fibrosis and or we do a liver biopsy. If the ALT is persistently 1 to 2 times, age is more than 35, family history of HCC or cirrhosis, we should treat these patients. Or if the ALT is more than 2 times upper limit of normal, we should directly treat these patients. In case of E negative chronic hepatitis B infection patients, well, there are only two things. One is less than 2000, one is more than 2000. In less than 2000, if the ALT is normal, we assess the fibrosis non-invasively, monitor ALT and DNA, individualize liver biopsy, and treat if there is moderate to severe inflammation or significant fibrosis. Significant fibrosis means F2, F3 fibrosis. If the ALT is upper limit, more than upper limit of normal, if elevated ALT, we have to exclude the other causes. We have to assess the fibrosis non-invasively and we have to monitor 3 monthly and individualize liver biopsy, like if the patient who has persistently elevated ALT, age more than 35 or family history of cirrhosis or HCC, we should do directly a liver biopsy, and in case of moderate to severe inflammation or significant fibrosis, we have to treat. The DNA is more than 2000 and ALT is 1 to 2 times upper limit of normal or normal, again the similar things, we have to assess, individualize liver biopsy and treat if there is moderate to severe inflammation or significant fibrosis. If the ALT is more than 2 times upper limit of normal, we should treat these patients, and we may initially observe for 3 months, but again we have to individualize and we should have low threshold for treating starting the treatment of these patients. For again the chronic HBV infected, for the decompensated cirrhosis, any HBV DNA detectability we should treat, and we should consider liver transplantation if there is no stabilization. For compensated cirrhosis, if there is a normal ALT DNA more than 2000 or if elevated ALT DNA detectable, we should treat, and if there is a reactivation we should immediately treat. Now let's see few case business. The first case is of a 45 years old male with HBCG positive in 2014, E negative, anti-E positive, ALT was 44, DNA was not detected. But now in 2020, again the ALT is 100, AST is 88, E negative, anti-E positive. Serum albumin and total bilirubin still are normal, and patient has overweight with BMI of 26.4. So what should we do? Should we, patient has most likely developed HCC, or the patient has an E negative immune reactivation chronic hepatitis B, which could be presumptively diagnosed by obtaining a serum DNA level? Or do you think that the patient is likely infected with a precore mutant HBV, or the patient's liver enzyme elevation is unrelated to hepatitis B? So of this, the answer is that patient has an E negative immune reactivation chronic hepatitis B, and which could be diagnosed by obtaining a serum DNA level. The patient in 2004, he was in the inactive phase of chronic hepatitis B. 20% of these patients in the inactive phase will transition to the E negative immune reactivation. This we have discussed in the previous slides. And this usually is by the mutation in the precore or core promoter gene. So in this patient, obtaining a DNA level would provide valuable information, and one would expect the DNA level to be elevated, which would be low in the inactive phase. Now the second case is a 34 years old injection drug users with a HBCG DNA of 10^7, E positive, anti-E negative. ALT is 135 and 96, 3 months apart. LSM is 12.5, which is indicative of F3-F4 fibrosis. NTHCV HIV is negative and liver ultrasound is normal. So what should we do in these cases? Should we do a liver biopsy, or should we start directly with the treatment? Or we should continue to monitoring as ALT appears to be settling, like in 3 months apart it has come down, or we should do a repeat E antigen to check for clearance. So for this we should see this algorithm proposed by ASLD, that is American Association, and this is very much similar to our APASL guideline which we have just discussed. So in these patients, the patient who has more than 2 times upper limit of normal, to both all the three societies recommend that in patients with a high DNA level, with high ALT level, we should monitor for 3 to 6 months, and we should treat if there is no spontaneous E antigen loss. So we should do this. In E negative patients, again, if there is a high DNA, ALT more than 2 times, all the three societies recommend that treatment is required, and liver biopsy rather is optional in these patients. The third case is of a 55 years old male with diabetes, BMI of 22, old history of blood transfusion in 1990, presented with jaundice followed by ascites in 3 weeks. His DNA is 10^7, E positive, anti-E negative, AFP is 211, which is high, AST is 786, ALT is 822, and IgM anti-HB core is positive, which is of the range of 1:200. Now, what is the diagnosis in this patient? Do we think because the patient has a high AFP, whether he has developed HCC, or the patient has a HBV reactivation, or the patient has acute hepatitis B, or he should be advised directly liver transplantation? So I would say that the patient has a HBV reactivation and he should be started directly on antivirals. The reason for this is that how do we differentiate between acute hepatitis B and reactivation? In acute hepatitis B, the patient will have a very high IgM anti-core titer, that is more than 1:1000. The HBV DNA is less than 10^5. There is absence of any mutation. There is a recent history of exposure in this patient. The history of exposure was 1990. And when treated as reactivation, 95% will show HBsAg loss. Whereas in reactivation, this IgM anti-HB titer is low. There is a very high HBV DNA, more than 10^4. Like in this patient, it is 10^7. There are presence of mutations. There is a previous history of hepatitis B in patient or in family members, and the patient is unlikely to clear HBsAg even after therapy. Another case is of 45 years old businessman, prior cholecystectomy a year ago. The patient will present with a fatigue and a routine health checkup shows HBsAg positive, BMI is 28.6, E positive, NTI negative, ALT is 45 and 48, DNA is 10 to the power 7 logs, FibroScan shows LSM of 8.9 which corresponds to F2 fibrosis, ASG, USG shows a mildly coarsened liver ecotexture. So what should we do in these patients? Important thing to remember is the age of this patient. Now, liver biopsy should be done in this patient. Why? Because the NASL guideline, EASL guideline and American and APASL guideline all says that treatment is not required in the immune tolerance phase, but because there is a likelihood of response to available treatment is low. But liver biopsy should be considered in persistently borderline normal or slightly increased ALT level like in this patient, particularly those older than age 40 and according to EASL guideline, that is European guidelines, age 30. And treatment should be recommended if the biopsy shows F2, F3 fibrosis or moderate to severe inflammation. Another case is of a pregnant lady, 32 years old, with 24 weeks of pregnancy, HBsAg is found positive. Patient has a normal ALT, but DNA is 10 to the power 5. So what should we do in this patient? Should the patient be asked to abort or we should ask to take nucleotide logs? So now the current guideline says the patient should be given tenofovir, which is safe, which is category B, and it can be done in all the three trimesters, but at least in the third trimester, that is after 28 weeks of pregnancy, irrespective of the DNA level. And the patient, when a child is born, HBIC is to be given and three doses of vaccination will be given. And after four, if the patient can, then after delivery, the nucleotide analog can be stopped depending on the case to case, and then the breastfeeding can continue. And last case, I think, is a 28 years female. This is an interesting case. The patient presented with a history of being married 11 months back, and the husband lived in Dubai. And 4 months back, he consulted some infertility center in view of not being able to conceive in the first 6 months, and incidentally was found to have HBsAg positive. She was complaining of weakness, easy fatigability, and shortness of breath. And patient's lab was done, which showed a very low hemoglobin level. LFT was more or less okay, and DNA was 10 to the power 5 log, E negative, and USG was also normal. An endoscopy was done, which showed many erosions in the stomach. And a biopsy was taken from this, which showed evidence of vasculitis. Her PNCA was positive. So we thought what to do next, because the liver was normal, DNA was 10 to the power 5, but E negative, ALT is normal, no family history of CLD or HCC. So should hepatitis B treatment be started? Now, these are the extrahepatic manifestations of hepatitis B, that is vasculitis, skin manifestations, polyarteritis nodosa, peripheral neuropathy, and glomerulonephritis. And it is seen that this HBsAg positive with extrahepatic manifestations and active HBV replication, they may respond to antiviral therapy. And in these patients, PEG interferon should not be used. And we started on this treatment, and all the lesions improved within 1 month. Okay, there's one more case. This is a 65 years old male patient, diabetic on oral hypoglycemics. He's a known case of CLL, that is lymphoma, on chemotherapy. The patient was diagnosed in 2014, and all the workup was done, and patient received say 5 cycles of chemotherapy, and last cycle was in September 2014, and the baseline investigation showed a normal LFT, but in October the patient developed jaundice, decreased appetite, generalized weakness. He was evaluated, found to have HBsAg positive. Patient was then started on entecavir. His bilirubin, which on 17th was 1, increased to 21 on 26th. AST LT was very high, and his LFT started showing. His CT was done, which showed now cirrhosis and ascites. And patient expired to after a few months. So any patients undergoing chemotherapy or immunosuppressive therapy should be tested for HBV markers prior to immunosuppression, and all HBsAg positive should receive either entecavir or tenofovir as treatment or prophylaxis. And HBsAg negative patients should also be checked for core total, and positive subjects should receive anti-HBV prophylaxis if they are at high risk of HBV reactivation. So I'll skip this one. So to summarize, in India, majority of chronic hepatitis patients are unaware of their infections. The clinical course of chronic hepatitis B consists of immune tolerant, immune clearance, inactive carrier, reactivation and resolution phase. Not all patients will go through every phase of infections. However, chronic hepatitis B patients are at risk for severe liver damage. And HPV screening is important to identify chronically infected persons who may need treatment and to allow for interventions to reduce transmission to others. HPV screening consists of simple blood tests for serological markers of infection. Screening, vaccination, and appropriate management of persons with chronic hepatitis B are important steps to help prevent hepatitis B and its liver complications. So gentlemen, hepatitis B is a treatable disease, but we need to know hepatitis B to for that. Thank you. Now I'll request Dr. Sufla to discuss of our new.
Thank you, Dr. Lavkesh. So after a wonderful presentation by Dr. Lavkesh on hepatitis B, I'm going to speak through on the topic neonatal cholestasis. Although it is a very elaborated topic, but I've tried to make it a bit concise with clinical pointers for easy diagnosis in day-to-day practice. So this is the most common cause of conjugated hyperbilirubinemia that you see in your practice. So I'm going to start with some cases that you see in your practice and how we should deal through with them. So usually these are the kind of cases that you see in your practice. A 2-month-old baby who's a term normal vaginal delivery. The jaundice was noticed since third week of life with dark urine and intermittent clay colored stool. The birth weight of the child was normal with a current, and he's gaining weight appropriately with all normal development signs and symptoms. There was no history of any consanguineous marriage with one healthy female sibling. And another, there could be a history of another male sibling who's expired with jaundice a couple of months ago. So on examination, it's a well-looking active child with extras over the body in the eyes, with a distended abdomen and a palpable liver and spleen. There was no murmur and all the other systemic examination is normal. So the pointers here are, this was the color of the stool initially, and later on the stool color changed to nearly clay colored. So it was a little bit pigmented initially to begin with, and then it lost the pigment. So this is a very clear cut pointer towards, you know, one of the possible diagnoses, that is biliary atresia, that we most commonly see. Then another presentation that could be a 4-month-old child with a term baby born by cesarean, non-consanguineous marriage, no other sibling, jaundice noticed since 1 month. The child is on examination could be mildly icteric with hepatosplenomegaly. Rest of the systemic examination is normal. There's no itching marks on the body, no purpura, no bruising. On investigation, you may see a raised enzyme with a normal gamma GT level. So this level is very, very important whenever you are dealing with a child with conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. The child may have mildly raised serum bilirubin levels with deranged coagulation profile. A HIDA scan done was normal. So these are the kind of presentation that we get in clinical practice, and then we have to decide about whether the neonatal cholestasis is because of the intrahepatic causes or the extrahepatic causes. So let's proceed and see you know, how we can diagnose and go about such children. The objective of my talk is when cholestatic liver disease should be suspected. How do we evaluate these infants with conjugated hyperbilirubinemia? What are the differential diagnoses and how do we manage them? So if you look by definition, there is a diminished bioformation or excretion in cholestasis. And Espigan and Lespigan has given clear definition that neonates and neonates who have jaundice beyond 2 weeks of age with a direct bilirubin of more than 1 mg/dL, if the total bilirubin is less than 5, and if the total bilirubin is more than 5, then it should be more than 20%. The IAP has given the guideline that the conjugated bilirubin of more than 1.5 or 2 mg in a newborn infant with a high colored urine with or without a colic stool. Now, if you look at the incidence, cholestatic jaundice is fairly common. So, in the Western world, one in every 2,500 live birth suffers from cholestatic jaundice. Biliary atresia is 1 in 10,000 to 15,000 infants. And idiopathic neonatal hepatitis is again fairly common, 1 in 5,000 to 10,000 live births. In India, however, neonatal cholestasis constitute around 19 to 30% of all the chronic liver diseases in children. So it is quite common. If you look at the etiology, we just to simplify it, we divide it into two causes. So either it is liver-related causes or it is bile duct or extrahepatic-related causes. So it's very important when a child presents, whether on based on the presentation, then clinical findings and investigation, you have to divide whether the child has got extrahepatic disease, that is like biliary atresia or polydactyly cyst. Or if it is an intrahepatic disease, then is it because of hepatocyte injury or bile duct injury? The hepatocyte injury can be because of multiple causes. They are roughly divided into metabolic, viral, and idiopathic, whereas bile duct injury can be because of bile duct paucity. Now, if you look at the Western world literature, the most common causes of neonatal cholestasis is extrahepatic biliary atresia, which is around 25%, followed by idiopathic neonatal hepatitis. Then they have the infectious causes, followed by parenteral nutrition associated, then metabolic, and then the rare syndromic causes. That includes PFIC as well. If you look at the Indian data, which has been given by IP, again, the most common causes are from the hepatocellular causes. The neonatal hepatitis, the idiopathic one is the most common, whereas we cannot find out the cause of this disease. Followed by TORCH infectious causes, in which there is TORCH infection, sepsis, other causes. Then there are obstructive causes are quite common. So they are around 38%, out of which 34% is constituted by biliary atresia. And then there are other causes which are metabolic, miscellaneous, and cholelocosis, in which they are bile salt transport disorder, bile acid synthetic disorders are also there, but they are quite rare. So if you look, this is the explanation for all the different causes, and they're being categorized. So in extrahepatic biliary obstruction, it can be because of biliary atresia, cholelocal cyst, inspecific bile or mucus plug. It could be because of cholelithiasis or tumor or masses or neonatal sclerosing cholangitis. These are quite rare as compared to biliary atresia. Then there are various infections like viral infections, which is much more common. Then bacterial infection, sepsis, protozoal infection. Followed by this, there are metabolic and genetic causes. Then which have been divided again into disorders of carbohydrate metabolism, amino acid metabolism, and lipid metabolism. So you see, this is quite common, like galactosemia and fructosemia, tyrosinemia. Then you see a Niemann-Pick disease in lipid metabolism. Then there are rare disorders, which are quite rare, in which there is disorders of bile acid synthesis because of deficiency of certain enzymes, which are responsible for synthesis of bile. In that also, we cover the Zellweger syndrome and Smith-Lemli-Opitz syndrome. Then there are inherited cholestatic disorder, which are much more common in the Western world as compared to our side of the world. So there are allergies, there are ARC, there is cystic fibrosis, then there is PFIC, which is quite common in India as well. Then there are mitochondrial disorders. And then again, other metabolic disorders in which there is alpha-1 antitrypsin and citrulline deficiency. Then it is also important to rule out endocrine disorders, hyperpituitarism, and then the hepatitis or cholestasis caused by drugs or parenteral nutrition. So children, especially preterm babies who are on parenteral nutrition on long time, are quite prone to develop neonatal cholestasis. They get better also once the parenteral nutrition is stopped. Then there are alloimmune disorders and miscellaneous disorders. So we have seen that idiopathic neonatal hepatitis, in which no cause has been found of neonatal hepatitis is quite common as well. So let's see what are the pointers in the history. Usually in the obstructive causes, it is a rough guide, but it is not the rule of the book. Usually you will see a history of full term baby with a normal birth weight, a colic stool, growing well, feeding well, with an uneventful antenatal history, or there will be no family history. This is the pointer towards biliary atresia or colitocosis or any other obstructive disease. And in non-obstructive causes or the hepatocellular causes, the baby is usually preterm or full term with a low birth weight, failure to thrive. Important thing is the baby will have pigmented stool. With poor feeding, there could be other pointers in the diagnosis. For example, if it is a viral neonatal cholestasis, then there could be history of fever, rash, or lymphadenopathy. They may have family history of another sibling affected by the same. If the child on examination is dysmorphic in appearance, think of allergy or trisomies. Cataract is quite common in babies who have got galactosemia. Similarly, in allergies, you look out for posterior embryotoxin in the lens. Then in torch anomalies or septo-optic dysplasia, retinal examination is very common because we know chorioretinitis is very, very common in torch infection. Sometimes biliary atresia is associated with situs inversus as well. Again, cardiac murmurs are seen in LHL and biliary atresia. There could be a mass when there will be a presence of polydobal cyst. And then again in septo-optic dysplasia, look out for micropenis. So these are rough clinical pointers which you can see on clinical examination and general examination of the child, which can point toward a certain diagnosis. Course of timely evaluation. The reason we want to timely evaluate these child is so that we can treat any medical or life-threatening condition. You know that these child can, their liver can get compromised very quickly. They can go into cirrhosis and acute liver failure. So they need to be diagnosed and treated on time. Obviously, we know that there is a crucial window for the surgery for biliary atresia. So such disorders which are treatable by surgery should be diagnosed and treated in appropriate time frame. And very, very important, a lot of intrahepatic disease are referred for surgical intervention without knowing the underlying cause. So such errors should be avoided by doing the right diagnosis. So let's see what all can be helped, you know, in terms of investigations to diagnose these disorder. So if you look at the liver function test, I discussed earlier as well that gamma GT levels are very, very important. Usually you see a raised gamma GT levels in extrahepatic biliary atresia or PFIC3, that is primary familial intrahepatic cholestasis type 3, not in 1 and 2, in primary sclerosing cholangitis and an allergy. So GGT along with the other liver function tests is a good pointer towards, you know, diagnosis of what kind of disorder it could be. In PFIC 2 and 1, it is usually normal, especially in bile duct disorders and bile synthetic disorders as well. Bile acid synthetic disorders, gamma GT could be normal. PT and ILR is severely, if it is severely abnormal, think about tyrosinemia, galactosemia, because it is usually associated with sepsis. Then look out for urine for reducing substance, especially in galactosemia, TORS screening, thyroid status, cortisol screening. If there is evidence of hypoglycemia, think about galactosemia or hypopituitarism. AFP levels are very, very high in tyrosinemia. But for the confirmation, it is very important that you do a urinary succinyl acetone levels, because AFP can be high in other condition as well. So that's why a confirmatory diagnosis is always warranted before starting the treatment. So again, I'll go for the gamma GT levels. If it is normal or low, think about neonatal hepatitis could be associated with idiopathic or hypopituitarism or bile acid synthetic disorder or PFIC 1 and 2. But if it is high, then think about either obstructive disorders or neonatal hepatitis. So usually in bilateral atresia, cholelithiasis, PFIC3, allergies, and it can be high in alpha-1 antitrypsin trypsin deficiency as well. So let's see the ultrasound scan. Usually in all the babies, it is being told that you should do a fasting ultrasound scan followed by a postprandial ultrasound scan. And this is the triangle, classical triangular cord sign that you see near the bifurcation of portal vein for confirmation of diagnosis of bilateral atresia. Now, why it is done, why it is very, very important, a good sonologist and a fasting scan, it can confirm if there is any other surgical treatable condition like cholelithiasis or incipient bile plug. Triangular cord sign, as I said, is diagnostic. Then abnormal gallbladder morphology. For example, the gallbladder is not visualized on a fasting scan, or the length is less than 1.9 centimeter, or there is the lining is not complete, or it's not smooth. The other thing is that no contraction of gallbladder happens after oral feeding. So that's why it's very important that you do a fasting scan first, and followed by that you do a postprandial scan to look for the contraction of gallbladder, and also non-visualization of the common bile duct. So these are all the diagnostic signs for diagnosing bilateral atresia. Now, afterwards, after this, we have to do the HIDA scan or the hepatobiliary scintigraphy scan. It has certain disadvantages, although to confirm the diagnosis of bilateral atresia, we always look for the excision of the dye. So we give the child technetium labeled dyes. It depends on the hepatocellular function and patency of the biliary tract. So if the child has got neonatal hepatitis, there will be delayed uptake, but there will be excretion. Whereas in biliary atresia, there will be a normal uptake, but there will be absent excretion. So it is 97% sensitive, but it is not specific for biliary atresia. It is very important to remember, whenever you do a scintigraphy scan, you have to prime the baby for 5 days with phenobarbital. So as I was saying, that there are certain disadvantages of HIDA scan, especially when we have a time lag or we don't have enough time for the baby to wait for the surgery. So always it's always better to go for a liver biopsy rather than waiting for 5 days to do a HIDA scan to confirm the diagnosis of bilateral atresia. So because there is undue delay because of the priming, and 40% cases of neonatal hepatitis will not show any excretion. And it has been shown that 20% cases, even which show excretion on HIDA scan, later prove out to be bilateral atresia. So it's not a very specific test. So this is the clinical picture. The positive finding is when you give the dye, there is uptake in the liver, and then there is excretion in the gallbladder in the early phase, and later on you can see the tracer activity in the jejunum as well. Whereas when there is biliary atresia, there will be no uptake and no excretion, and ultimately the dye will be seen in the bladder. There will be normal uptake in the liver, but there will be no excretion in the bowel. You can't visualize the biliary tree, and then you will see it in the bladder. So this is for biliary atresia. So now we come to the next step of investigation, which is liver biopsy, and it is the gold standard. It is very, very useful, especially in defining the etiology in up to 95% of cases. You can also find out the extent of fibrosis, and it also gives a clue to the diagnosis. So you can avoid unnecessary surgery if the child is not suspected to have biliary atresia, then you know, putting the child under knife is unnecessary. So it is very, very important in differentiating neonatal hepatitis and biliary atresia. Accuracy is around 83% to 97%. The mandatory requirement is that the prothrombin time should be normal. There should be no ascites or any other contraindication, and the platelet count should be normal. Sometimes complication may occur, but it is extremely rare. It can lead to bleeding if adequate precautions are not being taken, or peritonitis or pneumothorax. So this is the histological appearance. You can see bile duct proliferation in extrahepatic biliary atresia with bile flux. This is another picture in which you can see bile duct proliferation in biliary atresia. Now, in paucity of intrahepatic bile ducts, you can see that there are only few bile ducts because of lack of it. This is the histological picture. This is giant cell formation in neonatal hepatitis. In PFIC, again, you can see that there is not only bile duct proliferation, but there is also fibrosis. So following all this, if we still don't get the diagnosis, then we go ahead and do the genetic and enzymatic study. It is very important to remember, sometimes when you are investigating this child, you know, you will get multiple diagnoses, that you will find some amino acid to be raised in a TMS level. You will find that some of the IgM, especially the rubella IgM antibodies are, you know, raised. So you are always in a fix whether the child has got metabolic condition or viral condition or which treatment to start. So whenever you get this multiple kind of factors, it is always important to remember that for viral etiologies, the PCR should be done for confirmation the diagnosis, unless clinically the child has got all the clinical condition which fits into a viral induced cholestasis. Other than that, for genetic, you can do genetic and enzymatic studies, which do take time to come to confirm the diagnosis of the cause. So alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, you have the PIZZ gene which is responsible. Then you can do the CFTR gene for CF, GALT enzyme study for galactosemia. Then there are glycogen storage disorders. Then for hemochromatosis, usually you do the iron studies and then you look at the deposition of iron in the pancreas and iron. Then Niemann-Pick disease, you do the Niemann-Pick genetic studies. In citrulline deficiency, you look for citrulline and raised alpha fetoprotein with ferritin. Then in allergies, you see JAG and non-gene. And then in PFIC 1 to 3, you see the ABCB4 and ABCB11 ATP BAP1 genes. These are very, very common, that's why I'm discussing, because all these genetic and enzymatic studies are easily available and done nowadays to conclude the diagnosis of neonatal cholestasis. So let's look at the diagnostic algorithm. If a child who's coming to you is sick, has a positive septic screen, treat the sepsis, but you need to exclude galactosemia. If the septic screen is negative, then look out for other viral illness like CMV, HSV. Do a ferritin level, a urinary succinyl acetone level to exclude tyrosinemia, GALF level as well. If it is normal, then biopsy is optional. Sorry. If the child is not sick, look for pale stool. If there is pale stool, then do a fasting ultrasound scan and for gallbladder contractility. If it is normal, then biopsy is optional. If there is small gallbladder that you see on an ultrasound scan or absent gallbladder, it's important to exclude biliary atresia. For that, you need to go ahead with either with the liver biopsy or do an intra-op cholangiogram. And if there is evidence of polydocal cyst on ultrasound, then you have to do a surgery. If the stools are pigmented, then you do a sonography, look for any surgical cause. If there are not, then rule out for metabolic cause as well. In biliary atresia, if the age is less than 6 weeks, do a HIDA scan. After 3 days of priming, you look out for excretion. If there is no excretion, obviously you have to go ahead with the surgery. Again, no excretion, liver biopsy. If it is inconclusive, then intra-op cholangiogram with Kasai. If the age is more than 6 weeks, then directly go for liver biopsy. Don't wait for a HIDA scan. If the child with biliary atresia present to you after 3 months of age with ascites or maybe more than at 6 months of age, then it should directly be referred to the transplant center if the child has developed cirrhosis and ascites and needs a transplant. Now comes to the management. So we all know that liver needs a lot of nutrition this is of prime importance in any child who has got chronic liver disease. So it's very important to ensure that the child gets adequate nutrition. It could be breastfeeding with supplemental feeds, or you can give them a supplemental formula as well. But make sure that you provide all the adequate amount of carbohydrate, fats, and protein. the energy intake should be adequate with all the vitamins, fat soluble vitamins. These are the recommended doses of ADEK which needs to be given along with other minerals, calcium, phosphorus, vitamin, zinc and iron. Now pruritus is very, very common in cholestasis. So and it is very difficult to treat as well, especially in infants sometimes. Initially we start with the urso. If it doesn't get better, you can add rifampicin or phenobarbital. And if it doesn't get better, then you can give cholestyramine as well in the dose of 4 to 8 gram per day. All these are need to be given in divided doses. So let's look, if there are associated common conditions, then you need to treat. For example, if the child has got hypothyroidism or hypopituitarism, then you have to do hormone replacement. If the baby has got cholestasis because of galactosemia, then obviously elimination of dietary galactose, elimination of dietary fructose for fructose intolerance, tyrosine free formula for tyrosinemia, and for bile acid synthetic defects, you have to supplement oral bile salts. Now finally, if the child doesn't get better with all this and the child has got progressive or chronic liver disease, then the child should be referred for liver transplantation. The indication is decompensated liver disease, ascites or encephalopathy, or failed portoenterostomy. Now the survival rate for liver transplantation is very, very good. The 1 year survival rate is approximately 85 to 90%. 5 to 8 year survival rate is around 75 to 80%. And mostly the most common reason in child who go undergo liver transplantation, half of them belong to biliary atresia. So if the age of, I'm just going to skip this slide, it's not. So this was the study which was done in 1999, but the results are much better. Earlier the survivals used to be around 30 to 50%, and 10 year survival was around 23 to 43%. This has now gone up to about, the 5 year survival has gone up to around 85 to 90% in the recent times. So if you look at the long term outcome, the mean survival of biliary atresia patients who are untreated is around 19 months or maybe lesser. 3 year survival is less than 10%. But all this kid's life can be changed, saved if they are referred for an early liver transplant. Similarly, in neonatal hepatitis, 60% of the patient with idiopathic neonatal hepatitis will recover without any specific therapy. 10% die acutely because of bleeding or permanent hepatic failure, and 30% out of them can progress to progressive liver disease. So the key message I would like to give from my presentation is early referral, early diagnosis is the key to save the child with or baby with chronic liver disease. Congenital infection is the most common cause of cholestatic jaundice. Percutaneous liver biopsy is safe and most useful tool for diagnosing of any kind of chronic liver disease in babies. And surgery for biliary atresia and cysts should be done before 2 months of age. With that, I thank you for your patient listening, and we are gonna take the questions from you.